Let's face it, most people don't take the triangle very seriously. And I honestly don't blame them. Even in popular culture, the triangle gets some pretty silly attention. Like in this car insurance commercial.
Yeah!
Or the Florida Orchestra's better real-life version. Or even this, by Argentine cartoonist Kino. And if you're a percussionist yourself, you've probably had someone come up to you and ask why someone gets paid money to play this instrument. On a certain level, the triangle deserves this. As Utah Symphony percussionist Eric Hopkins says in his blog post, How to Be a Professional Triangle Player, the truth is that anyone can play the triangle. It's one of the most basic musical instruments. I mean, its name is the shape. You hit a triangle-shaped piece of metal with another piece of metal, and ding! No worries about hitting a wrong note or playing out of tune. You don't even have to bother with note length. Just hit it, and you're done. But in the rest of the article, he goes on to describe it's not quite that simple. A favorite comeback for percussionists when defending the triangle is to quote the legendary journalist George Plimpton, who was famous for his participatory journalism. He would do things like act in a movie, play in a professional sporting event, do a stand-up comedy act, and then write about these experiences from his point of view as an amateur. He famously also once performed with the New York Philharmonic under Leonard Bernstein and had this to say, I am often asked which of the participatory exercises I have been involved in was the most frightening. People are always startled when I say that the one that frightened me the most was not playing football with the professionals, or basketball, or boxing, but when I played with the New York Philharmonic. I played the triangle. Personally, I feel like this back and forth about the triangle is the perfect representation of why I love percussion so much. It's probably the most accessible group of instruments because it seems like anyone can play them. In this sense, I think it makes it easier for us to connect with audiences. And yeah, it's true. Anyone can walk up to the triangle and make not the worst sound. Maybe even approach a mediocre level. But of course, to get from a mediocre to professional level on percussion instruments takes years of training. And I'm here to give you a little bit more insight into what it takes to really play the triangle professionally. First, let's take a look at the choice of instruments. Not all triangles sound the same, and part of being a professional triangle player is knowing which instrument to choose for which moment in a piece of music. Here's my triangle collection, which is a pretty typical amount for a professional percussionist. Out of an entire collection, a percussionist probably has a few go-to favorites and leaves the others for more unique moments. And here are my three favorites that are a pretty good representation of the range of instruments available today. As I play each triangle, I recommend wearing headphones so you can really hear the differences between them. But I'll also include a frequency chart to further demonstrate their sound qualities. On this chart, you'll see the frequencies on the x-axis and how loud those frequencies are when you play the triangle on the y-axis. What you get from this is a visual representation of how many low, mid, and high frequencies are heard. If you see spikes in this area, then you know it's a more full-sounding instrument with plenty of low and mid frequencies. The number of spikes you see in the higher frequency area shows you how pure or shimmery the sound is. This will all make more sense when we start comparing instruments. Here's what the first one, a Sabian 7-inch hand-hammered bronze triangle, sounds like. This instrument specifically is a bit more shimmery than other triangles, and we see plenty of spikes in the high frequencies. It also has a strong representation of both mid and low frequencies. Among other things, I love using it for single notes in solo moments of rich-sounding large orchestral works like Richard Strauss's Ein Heldenleben. So now you might be thinking, okay, yes, we chose the right instrument, but I can still just walk up to it and go ding, especially in this part since there is literally one note to play. Yeah, that's true, but there are still many variables to consider even for that one ding. When we train as percussionists, we learn how to use sticks and mallets to hit a large collection of instruments, With each strike, we must use the exact right amount of energy and finesse depending on the desired sound or type of surface we're hitting. Although each instrument has its own considerations, we use our general knowledge and training to apply our technique to each specific situation. In this case, using a metal triangle beater and hitting the metal surface of the triangle brings up considerations about how long the beater momentarily stays on the triangle when we hit it. If I hit it with a slower stroke, the beater itself actually rests on the surface of the triangle longer, muting some of the frequencies and creating a more mellow sound. And vice versa if I use a quicker stroke. Once we have the right sound from the stroke, we have to make sure we hit the triangle in the exact right spot on the instrument. Moving even an eighth of an inch can produce an entirely different sound on certain triangles. Listen to the differences as I play this triangle in five different spots. Watch on the frequency chart here to see how the low and mid frequencies change from being less and more full, and over here to see how the number of spikes in the high frequencies change. The next triangle, an Alan Abel 6-inch symphonic triangle, is probably the most pure sound you could find in a professional instrument. It really highlights more of the upper frequencies, and we can tell by comparing it to the first triangle. See how there are less spikes in the high frequencies and almost no spikes in the mid and lows? Although many percussionists use it across all different styles of orchestral music, for my taste, it's best for orchestral pops concerts and situations where you need to blend with brighter instruments in the orchestra. A great spot for this is the third movement of Dvorak's Symphony No. 9, where the triangle accompanies the upper woodwinds and strings. Let's take a closer look at that part. We see this rhythm, which repeats itself 14 times. This is really just an abbreviated way of writing two triplets with an eighth note at the end. Or more simply, we have to play 7 quick hits on the triangle in a row. The tempo is too quick to play 7 hits in a row like we normally would. So we have 2 options to play this part, each which produced a different sound. We can use one hand and bounce the triangle beater back and forth between the 2 sides in the corner. Or we can mount the triangle on its side and play the rhythm with 2 beaters and 2 hands. You might have even noticed that in the performance we just watched, the percussionist chose the first option. To play it this way, we have to do something called a triangle upstroke. And it's unique in that it requires us to hit a surface that is above our striking implement rather than just below it. This motion has to be perfectly even with the downstrokes as we bounce back and forth in the corner of the triangle. This last instrument is a vintage Leedy and Ludwig 10-inch triangle from probably the 1940s or 50s. It's on the larger side of professional triangles and covers the sound spectrum pretty evenly. If we compare it to the first instrument, we see that it has a similar frequency profile, but it has louder peaks in the highs and mid and lows. It's perfect for loud moments in a full orchestral texture, like the end of Mahler's Symphony No. 1. In this moment, we have something in our part called a trill, which is basically a drum roll, but on the triangle. When we hit the triangle, it rings for a long time on its own. But when a composer wants the sound to sustain for even longer, this is what they write. To play this on a triangle, you once again have to use your triangle upstroke technique to bounce the beater back and forth in the corner. These are just a few considerations that a professional triangle player must make. And hopefully by now, you are well on your way to becoming a high-level triangle aficionado. Next time someone says, "How hard is it to even play the triangle?" you can chime in with your very own, "Well, actually..." Just be careful not to mansplain. Is there anything else you'd like to know about the triangle? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks for watching!